Welcome to this special edition of the Strategy Driven Podcast, an interview with Don Schmincke, co-author of High Altitude Leadership, What the World's Most Forbidding Peaks Teaches Us About Success. Hi, I'm Nathan Ives, and I would like to welcome you to this special edition of the Strategy Driven Podcast, an interview with Don Schmincke, co-author of High Altitude Leadership, What the World's Most Forbidding Peaks Teaches Us About Success. The Strategy Driven Podcast focuses on the tools and techniques executives and managers can use to improve their organization's alignment and accountability to ultimately achieve superior results. These podcasts elaborate on the best practice and warning flag posts found on the Strategy Driven website at www.strategydriven.com. In this special edition podcast, Don Schmincke, founder of the SAGA Leadership Institute, shares his insights on the key traits and principles followed by truly successful leaders. So now, without any further delay, let's get started. We are privileged to be joined by Don Schmincke, co-author of High Altitude Leadership, What the World's Most Forbidding Peaks Teach Us About Success, and founder of the SAGA Leadership Institute, an organization that helps CEOs achieve outstanding results in strategy, leadership, sales, and cultural alignment. From CNN to the Wall Street Journal, his use of anthropology and evolutionary genetics to remedy the high failure rates of management theories has established him as a consultant renegade and leading global authority. Don, welcome to the Strategy Driven Podcast.
Thank you. Good to be here.
Well, thrilled to have you on the show. Loved your book. In fact, just overwhelmed with the actual stories that you and Chris wrote about from your experience on climbing so many of the world's just, well, not just the highest, but the most dangerous peaks. And just phenomenal. Just phenomenal. Love the book. And in fact, to start out with, you know, one of the things that I learned, I guess, from my Navy career is I came to respect the fact that when people are in stressful situations, they tend to fall back on their fundamental beliefs and behaviors. And it seemed to me, as I read High Altitude Leadership, that you really had the perfect laboratory then for observing kind of that raw or pure leadership behavior, both good and bad. I was wondering if you could describe for our listeners how you were able to observe and then synthesize all those leadership traits and behaviors that you talk about in High Altitude Leadership.
Well, it was an interesting time for us because I was looking for a new laboratory, so I was kind of open to the possibility of all that happening. I had, you know, I wrote the Code of the Executive back in the 90s, and then that went into 10 languages, and then it's still hitting bestseller list in the CEO and executive segment. So it's kind of cool. But I then we got into evolutionary genetics and how that applies to leadership, and did that for about, I guess, since the late 90s, and then I was ready for something new. So in the process of saying, okay, we've been using anthropology and evolutionary genetics to dispel a lot of common management theories and explain why the failure rates on a lot of management theories and a lot of strategies are so high, I was kind of in a point of, well, in this particular place, I was climbing with Chris Warner. Because for a whole other reason, we were there to raise money for a breast cancer vaccine at Johns Hopkins. It was sort of a charity event. We were climbing the highest active volcano in the world, and it was at that point at around 20,000 feet where I realized, oh, this is a great laboratory because there are no motivational speakers here, and there's no, you know, management experts. I mean, it's just raw biology, functioning in extreme areas. And so I asked Chris to do a book with me where he could be my my guide as we go through to explore this new lab. And it was a remarkable journey. He was filming the NBC special, one of the most successful K2 summit later that year. So we actually had a live laboratory to work with. So not only did we have 150 of Chris's previous expeditions data ready to go, but this live event gave us several months while he was in Pakistan, and we linked up via satellite to really take it forward. And what we discovered was something that was totally unpredictable. I was expecting to find some new leadership theories that would apply to help us do, you know, strategy and leadership better, but we didn't find any. I mean, you know, most leadership theories are, well, they've been around for thousands of years. I think we're regurgitating a lot of them. But what we discovered was that the greatest leaders seem to have this capacity to avoid certain danger.
Okay.
And this area of danger avoidance became a whole new area that had never been published before in the literature and certainly never studied. So it took us, and it caught us by surprise, and took us in an entirely new direction of leadership research. And so using the stories and the, you know, the metaphors from the climbing experiences helped us to really not only use real case studies from climbing, but also show how in corporations avoiding danger may be one of the overlooked keys for profitability and performance.
Okay. Well, now, Don, in the book, you outline or present 8 leadership dangers. I was wondering if you could just briefly describe what those are for our listeners.
Yeah, the danger started off with, and it was funny, we weren't really in any particular sequence at the time, but later it looked like it was better to do it in a certain way. We actually started off with the death experience because we found that that death was one of the things that Chris had just recently dealt with while he was on the mountain and on K2, which is the second, for the listeners who don't know, K2 is the second highest mountain in the world, and it is the most dangerous mountain in the world. Some people don't realize that, but that is exactly what it is. And we, just to give you an idea, that people obviously think of the evidence of Everest being certainly a great epic journey, but the death to summit ratio, interesting sport, death to summit ratio, but that ratio in Everest is really in the single digits. So most people that climb actually will stay alive. On K2, it's an entirely different situation, because on K2, it's, I think Chris said it's like 24%, something in that range. It kills about 1 out of 5 climbers going up and takes out another 1 out of 7 coming down. Mm-hmm. So even though about 500 or more people will summit Everest every year, only a couple hundred or so have summited K2 in the entire history of the world, just to give you an example of the difference between those two types of climbs.
Okay, yeah.
And so anyway, death became an interesting one because Nima, who was a Sherpa for the Korean team, actually had slipped and slid down the bottleneck, which is a notoriously difficult area. And for some reason, as an experienced Sherpa, he didn't self-arrest on the way down, although he had plenty of time to do that. So we're not quite sure what happened, but he ended up going off the edge. And, you know, they're probably now at 28,000 feet, so he'll fall for several minutes before he hits the glacier below. And his body would never be recovered, and we noticed that at that point in time, the entire team just froze. They just stopped, and people just, you know, like the summit bid was totally at risk now because people were just not willing to move forward. But when Chris, who is no stranger to dealing with these situations, accepted the death, realized that, hey, if I didn't think this was going to happen, I'm on the wrong mountain. You know, once he accepted the death, he climbed up past the cranes and started laying out the rope. And once people saw that, they begin following, and they're the most successful summit in history that day. Companies, same thing happens, though. It could be the death of a career, death of a client, death of a market, death of a product line, and people tend to freeze up. In this case, it's the death of an economy. People
sure.
start slowing down. They start getting nervous. They start, they lose the freedom to innovate, the freedom to move on. And so when we work with clients, because we do spend a lot of time doing strategic planning with clients, doing executive team development with clients, et cetera. And so we get to see this stuff right in the field. And when they can accept that death, the freedom unleashes and innovation unleashes. And so what we're doing now is we're getting a lot of demand for our services only because I think people are saying, geez, now it's time to get serious. You know, we can't afford to slow down now. We can't, you know, this is the time where the strong will get stronger and the weak will be taken out. And so that first chapter became, I think, very relevant, not only for the reader in terms of danger number one to avoid, but also an application in this time of our economy.
Absolutely.
The others, to answer your question, were things like selfishness. Obviously, that's rising in some corporations, too. And we see the impacts of some selfish behaviors on Wall Street today that's causing a lot of news. The third seduction seemed to be of most interest to a lot of the CEOs because we also do workshops for executive teams for about half a day, and I'll train about 1,000 CEOs a year in these workshops. And in the process of doing that, I'm finding that tool seduction is sort of gravitates to a lot of people. They seem to say, "Oh, wow, this is what's happening in my company." And by tool seduction, it's that capacity for humans to get so seduced by their tools, they totally forget about what it was they were trying to do in the first place.
Sure.
And we see that throughout history, where companies who have won some of the top quality awards in the world end up going bankrupt, you know. And some of the people that end up on the top 10 list, every year you get the top 10 company list of some, there's a number of these lists that get published every year, but they usually don't last on those lists. And so we wanted to find out what was going on with that. And tool seduction seems to be the issue. You know, people get seduced by their tools. And the tools could look like organizational change programs, development programs, TQMs, Six Sigma, reengineering. I mean, you just go through the list of all the fashion trends on management thought. And when you dig deeper, and I'm a scientist, I never meant to be doing this kind of work. I mean, my background's in planetary physics. I'm looking at, it's one thing when you look at, physical systems failing, but it's another thing looking at human systems. And, you look at the failure rates of top management theory, and those failure rates never make it to the books. They end up on the shelves on academic studies. But they're so extremely high, and that's really what attracted me to this area, was to study why the failure rates are so high and how to avoid them. And that kind of has been leading our research for 20 years. And so tool seduction is an area which drives a lot of the failure rates. Just today I was on the web, and actually it was about a week ago, and I found out that Hershey Corporation was looking at selling to Nestle. And, of course, the community is in a big uproar about that, because here's one of the last American icons for chocolate selling overseas. And as I was doing some preliminary Google research, I found a lot of blogs that were saying they got distracted by their ERM system, the new ERM management system they were implementing. Okay. And they forgot to sell chocolate. So, tool seduction takes strategic thinking offline in a way. And people get so enamored by the tool, they end up losing markets, losing profits. Strategic planning suffers.
Okay.
So a lot of the work we do is how to overcome that seduction.
All right. And it seems to me that so many of these are behavioral in nature. And I think of a person's leadership as being behavioral. Do you think leadership is something that a person kind of naturally has, or is it something that somebody can actually learn?
That's a good question. As a scientist, I originally thought that, you know, leaders are made, not born, but as we got more into the genetics and looking at the failure rates of leadership training programs, we began to realize that there was something else going on here. And you know, I could have 20, 30 CEOs in a room, and when I raise the point, they all seem to acknowledge, and they just look at the floor shaking their head that, yeah, about 90 days after the trainers leave, everybody resorts back to their old previous behaviors. And I'm just curious, because it wasn't like people were looking at me saying, oh, that never happens. I mean, our training programs are really, really good. No, they were kind of like, you know, behind the closed doors, accepting that, you know, you're right, we waste a lot of money on this stuff. And so in our studies of those failure rates, we began to realize that there were certain genetic, biological factors that actually affect how leaders perform. And none of the training programs that we saw or evaluated actually addressed them. You know, very few niche areas actually even raised the point, because it was so politically incorrect. And I,
sure,
you know, I do a lot of keynote speaking at industry conferences around the world, and they seem to love it, because they keep hiring me to speak, and I enjoy doing it. But I tell the audiences, you know, what we're going to talk about is politically incorrect, but scientifically accurate. So whether you use it or not, it's up to you. But generally, people say, oh, my God, thank you. Somebody's finally saying it. Somebody's finally admitting it. Somebody's finally putting it out there. You know, but it was never our intention to start a revolution. We were just really more interested in understanding the scientific platform behind this stuff. But yeah, leadership behavior is driven by a number of things. Some of the remarkable work started 30-some years ago with like Dr. Elliot Jacks finally identifying there's a brain capacity for handling cognitive complexity, and that severely limits a person's strategic thinking ability. That's one example. You can get more and more. A lot of this is published, by the way, in the medical journals and the scientific journals. But
sure.
Alterations in hormonal levels within a human, gender-specific differences, things like that. I mean, I hate going into a negotiation without a female in the room, for instance, because the sensitivity that they have, are, you know, guys are so incompetent when it comes to recognizing certain things. I mean, my wife's very successful in real estate because of her, I think a lot of it is her ability to sense what's going on in the room, and I look around like I don't even notice. And so it's these things that are just so sensitive and so politically incorrect, but I tell you, leaders that use it excel. They just excel. And I think it's time for us to start accepting the facts and the data, and not try to spin ways to, you know, to deny or avoid what is obviously in front of us. So these, to answer your question, sure, I think it's more biological than,
okay,
you know, than learned.
Okay. Wow. Yeah, and I'm guessing I might get some email too.
I might
get some email. Yeah,
it, you know, in the book High Altitude Leadership, and we reference, and in all the keynote speeches I do, we reference. I give everybody the scientific research studies. I mean, so we've got 300-400 published. Articles from some of the best scientists in the world and geneticists. So it's kind of like, you may not agree, but unless you have research that dispels it, you know, then you're left with denial as your only option.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, and I like to say the numbers don't lie. And it kind of gets hard to refute with all the studies that have been done.
Mm-hmm.
So. Well, Don, there was a concept you mentioned in high altitude leadership that I wanted to ask you to talk a little bit about, and that was the concept of creating a compelling saga for the organization. And I was hoping that you could describe for us how that works with or aligns with the organization's existing mission and vision and values.
Yeah, the SAGA came out of our studies of the ancient Norse, because we noticed that a lot of bankrupt companies had a lot of great mission statements and vision statements and all that stuff, and we're like, well, why are they failing when they have these things? And we found out that most people hold their missions as just content. You know, it's something that they filled in the blanks, they put it on a poster up on the wall, and like everything was supposed to be okay, but they really never believed in it. And so we started getting into ontological research of how beliefs drive behavior, and how behavior, you know, those actions, those decisions that people have to make every day, are not really driven by the tools, you know, which by the tools, again, going back to tool seduction, which is the contentual or process-driven type of methods, but really from the beliefs themselves. And when we notice that high-performance leaders seem to create these compelling sagas, you know, and they've been doing it for thousands of years, and it's this language that sort of inspires passion for a strategic result. And it's not like something that necessarily has to be, you know, put up on a poster, but it's something that lives and breathes in the company. So we saw that as one of the ways of giving people something to die for or subjugate their ego's selfish agenda for a higher cause. So the danger of selfishness gets avoided in companies who have great sagas. Everybody kind of says, because we challenge CEOs with this. It's like, oh, well, we've got a mission statement, and it's inspiring. It's like, how many people die for that? You know, how many people are willing to give up and sacrifice and persevere? I said, we're not talking about a motivational statement here. We're talking about the ancient Greek stories and the stories throughout history of, you know, the good and the bad, you know, the tough journeys, the perseverance to the summit, the things that take people to the new worlds. And I think that's why the companies with sagas can survive downturns better than those who just had a bunch of motivational speakers and posters hanging up.
Okay. Is it like a story? And I guess I'm thinking of some of the leaders that I've known that I find have been more motivating to me. Is it they've kind of created that story of us. It's here's our story, and I've got this visual of
it has to live like a story, and it could just be one statement or just a few words, you know, and it doesn't have to be. And then there's a lot of examples in the book High Altitude Leadership that goes into some detail with this, but it's the story that I give an example, like when FedEx about, I don't know, 17 years ago, published on the front page how Smith was exciting his people by getting up there and talking about the red, white, and blue trucks going after UPS. He was counting it in a story of the red, white, and blue against the brown shirts. Mm-hmm. And it was kind of like, you know, of course the UPS weren't, you know, this wasn't World War II, and of course, you know, they weren't the communists or the Nazis or the fascists, but it didn't matter. He chose an enemy, and he went after it, and couched as a simple story. It was just in a phrase, and yet it inspired them to action in a way that captured their passions. And I thought, well, that was kind of interesting. I mean, it wasn't like he had to have a, you know, some neat little mission statement hanging on the wall. No, these guys were showing up for work because they were like fighting a war for America.
Sure.
And some of these guys weren't even getting paid. I mean, they were like, he was starting the company. People were like betting on the outcome. So you see that happening in a lot of companies, and it is not something new. We've been using it as humans for thousands of years to inspire people.
Okay. Now, I'm thinking that the compelling saga then is not something we'd put into the business plan because then it's just going to get dusty on the shelf. Have you seen methods that leaders have used to communicate it? And I'm thinking maybe not just at the executive level, but like department managers or division managers. Is it just a story they share over and over at their staff meetings? How do they communicate the saga?
Well, what we found out is that a lot of it happened naturally once you're able to develop it vital way. For instance, when we started studying strategic planning failure rates, and you don't have to look far to find them. In fact, Henry Mintzberg wrote a great book, The Rise and Fall of Strategic Planning. And what did Tom Peters say about the 5% success rate of strategic planning was wildly inflated or something?
Okay.
So we didn't have to go far to start studying it and to figure out how to turn it around to be successful. What we realized was that SAGAs were not invented first, and then you went into your strategic objectives and action plans out of that. It was really developed last, and it almost went backwards. And when we started doing that type of strategic planning with clients, their profitability, their market share penetration accelerated tremendously. And basically all we did is we said, look, how do you figure out how to win? Because the SAGA has to capture winning, and whatever that means. And that means you have to understand several things that the generals have asked before battle for thousands of years, and that is, hey, where do we position ourselves on the battlefield, and who's the enemy? And once we figure out those things, it's easier to develop what winning means, and we have what winning means, and the SAGA is easy to craft upon that, you see. And so, in a sense, it's the engagement of the people in defining winning that gives birth to the SAGA. So you don't have to, like, go into a room with a lot of banners and say, okay, here's our new SAGA, and everybody looks at you like, oh, great, here we go again. Somebody got seduced by another tool, and now we had another banner.
That's right.
New coffee cups, everybody rolls their eyes. It's more of a journey. The communication, I think, happens with behavior and with action and with how people are being with each other. In that journey to define winning. And once you create it, then it's easier to communicate because it's now part of the fabric of your culture.
Sure. Okay. And I guess thinking back on my career, I can think of just one instance where I've had a manager that I've worked for who wanted to create that story before we created our plan.
Mm-hmm.
So he did it the right way, but he was clearly in the minority. And it was, what do we want people to write about us, and what story do we want to have told 10 years from now?
Mm-hmm. Right.
About where we've been, what we accomplished.
And you came in the Naval Academy, right? So, I mean,
that's right.
You look at naval history, and you had to figure out who the enemy was first, so you just don't show up for a war not knowing who the enemy is, and how you want to position the fleet.
Right.
You know, and yet none of that happens in modern strategic planning. It's very analytical. Kenichi Omai said it best in his book, The Mind of the Strategy. He says, true strategy lies beyond the reach of conscious analysis. And so that eliminates most strategic planning in this country. He says it really lies in the domain of intuition. And so strategy is about intuition. It's about how do you out-intuit the enemy's moves. And yet, when we look at strategic planning in companies, we rarely see intuitive shifts, belief shifts in the people. But when we introduce those shifts, everything changes.
Okay. All right.
So that's why we put it in the book, so people can maybe start rethinking how they're doing strategy and leadership.
Yeah. No, I loved it in the book, and I know in the book you had the illustration of how all the alignment was, and I was just kind of blown away with the concept. It was not something I had thought of before. But like I said, reflecting back, I can think of the single instance in my career where it was used, and it was used so successfully because it did. It added a lot of clarity of what then we needed to go forward and go do.
Right.
And we built our plan, but I had not seen anyone use it. So when I read that part of the book, it was kind of an eye-opener and a revelation for me that, oh, this is what was being done.
Yeah, and it's unfortunate that a lot of what we teach isn't really adopted in the business schools. You know, and so the reason probably why you only sold it one time and not 100 times is because this stuff is not taught. It's, I don't know, a bit too controversial, too provocative, not too politically incorrect. But every time you use it, you see performance results.
Right. Yep. And in fact, I would suggest even not just the performance results, but the way this manager, I think, involved folks in coming up with the story, we had greater buy-in, which got us our performance results.
Yeah.
But I think the organization as a whole held this particular leader in so much higher esteem, and was and his people were much more ready to follow him and, yeah. and trust in his leadership. So he built a great sense of trust and confidence too.
Well, you know, it's funny you bring that up, because it is one of the theories of management and leadership that we've dispelled. And, you know, when we do our workshops or our keynote speeches, often I will bring this up if it's appropriate. And that's like, we've been teaching you that followers follow leaders, and yet that is not true. You know, because everybody talks about followers following the leader. Well, what our research has shown, the reason that leadership training has failed so dramatically is yeah. because what followers are following is they're following the story the leader represents. So if a leader doesn't have a story to follow, they're not really leading, are they? I mean, they're going to be supervising, but they're not leading.
Yeah, or maybe they're using title and giving some direction.
Right.
Yeah. But certainly if you're at that point, you are not leading if you're relying on your title to be able to give some direction.
Right.
Yeah.
Which brings us to one of the dangers, by the way, is arrogance.
Mm-hmm.
And now that we're seeing, like the automakers today coming to Congress looking for a handout, we begin to realize that they knew how to make these changes early on, but all the data was ignored, because when I talked to all the suppliers, I did a tour to Detroit like about 3 or 4 weeks ago to the speech store, and I did like 7 speeches and workshops, mostly with CEOs of the companies in the area. And most of these are suppliers, obviously, to the auto industry. And the one thing that came up consistently was the arrogance of General Motors and these automakers to ignore all the data because they thought they knew everything.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. And being a viewer of CNN and other cable networks, it seems like to me that they were very arrogant even when they were sitting in front of Congress.
Yeah. I think the American people saw that.
Yeah, the whole private jet thing, I think, struck everyone just a little awkwardly.
I mean, it seems so obvious now, but when we saw the danger, and of course we put that in the book, it was just a matter of like, oh my God, this is, how do you avoid that danger? Because that's important. It's going to affect a lot of people at some point in history, and the great leaders seem to have a way around it, and so that's what we talked about.
Okay. Don, I know we're running out of time, but before we closed, I did want to ask you about your website, www.highaltitudeleadership.com, and the additional resources that you offer on the website. And I specifically wanted to ask you if you could talk a little bit about the High Altitude Leadership Team Assessment. That's
sure,
available.
Yes. There's a free download there. What we thought we'd do is for people that wanted to start applying this immediately, they could download a free assessment tool. And it's something we just put together very quickly, but I think it's actually very useful. It's got a little facilitator's sheet on it and a couple of handouts, which list all of the dangers and what they are. And then it's an exercise to help the team understand what are the top 2 or 3 dangers they really should be thinking about. And then, of course, we offer the solutions, the survival tips, and so it should lead to a very engaging exercise with any management team or group within an organization that wants to explore that. And also on the website, we have links to Chris Warner's Earth Treks company, which has some of the most outrageous and challenging outdoor leadership development. In fact, they do a lot of work with Wharton and the other business schools now looking at sending MBAs to this program. And then we also have links to the SAGA Institute, where we offer, obviously, strategic planning, leadership, and keynote speaking services.
Yeah. It seemed to me, and I just to ask you a little bit more about the team assessment, as a team identified the potential dangers they could fall into, I saw that as a tool, too, to help them in their decision-making process. So as the leadership team of an organization is coming to maybe a major decision on where to take the company or an initiative to go forward with, they could think about these potential traps and, if nothing else, assess their decision to see if they're kind of falling into one of the pitfalls.
Yeah, that's a great application. A great application, because if it could have helped GM or something. You know, what if somebody in GM said, look, every meeting when we make a decision, we're going to say, are we falling into the pitfall of arrogance here?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Would they have arrived at different decisions, you know, years ago that would have prevented them falling so far behind Toyota and all the others?
Oh, yeah. And what I find in my work with different teams is that they tend to fall into the same pitfalls over and over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
And so something to help them recognize the pitfall would just graphically help them in their decision-making across the board, because it tends to be a repeat behavior.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Well, Don, I want to thank you not only for sharing your time with us, but your tremendous insights on leadership.
Okay.
And I've thoroughly enjoyed high-altitude leadership. In particular, I love the vivid stories of the mountain or mountains that you and Chris have climbed, and the way you've depicted the leadership behaviors that you were able to observe in that laboratory setting. Again, just so vivid and came across so well, and it helped me to really kind of visualize then how I might be able to improve my behaviors and that of the organizations that I work with around me, and bring those lessons to bear at home. So again, I want to thank you, and I'd also wanted to encourage our listeners to go out and pick up a copy of High Altitude Leadership, which we'll have links on the website, but of course they can also get that through Amazon.com. So thank you.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for joining us. We hope you enjoyed this special edition of the Strategy Driven Podcast. I would also like to personally thank Don Schmincke for being with us today and sharing his insights on high-altitude leadership. As always, we would appreciate receiving your feedback by email at podcast@strategydriven.com. If you enjoyed the show, please consider voting for us on Podcast Alley and visiting our website at www.strategydriven.com. You can find more information about Don Schmincke and High Altitude Leadership at www.highaltitudeleadership.com. Until next time, so long.